Hello, everybody, and thank you, Ilaria, for the introduction. Thank you also to the organizers for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here and to have the possibility to present some results about how we can combine the different plain text space in the context of secret computing and more specifically in the context of the fully homomorphic encryption and in the framework Chimera. I work for Inpher. Inpher is a startup for privacy preserving computation, and our main product now is multi-party computation, and in the research topic we also work on the fully homomorphic encryption. Why secret computing? The first goal of the secret computing is to run an arbitrary computation over a secret and private data, and of course on a public environment. That means that we just want to compute privacy preserving computation without relying on the hardware security. There are many different use cases, and really the need to manipulate private data, and in really different domain and with different kind of computation. One of my favorite example is from one real situation, the collision in 2009 between two satellites. And that show really the necessity to predict the trajectories of two different of many satellites, and of course the trajectories are not always public, and the position is it's usually secret. That means that we need to run a private computation to evaluate a nonlinear function with high precision. Another domain that the privacy preserving is really important in our days is the domain of medicine and genomic. And as we know from several years, we have different examples in the IDASH competition with different application as the security genotype imputation of this year with the fully homomorphic encryption, or the secret parallel genome-wide association studies from the last year. Of course, also in the domain of the hospital, we have many data that we need to use in practical way, for example, for the predictive healthcare or to find the good dosage for a cure. And my last example is the domain of finance and banking. In one of the example this year is the fraud detection from the FCA competition, or also a different way to analyze banking or financial data to improve the investment models. And one last example is the application for secure e-banking, where the computation can be just a comparison between the actual money in the account, if it's positive or negative, to allow the transfer of money or not. What is the common part of all these examples is that we need a privacy preserving computation. But all of them are completely different, and they work on completely different plain text model. In some of them we need really to use the binary plain text, for example, in a way to perform a comparison. In some other application, the natural or the native plain text space are the integers, and at the end for all physics are fixed point computation, we need really some kind of approximate computation. There are many different privacy preserving techniques with different properties and with that are really good for different kind of use cases. We have the anonymization that it's fast and easy, but cannot be applied, for example, in the genomic data because the identifiant is inside of the data. The differential privacy, it's also a fast and efficient method, but if we want to obtain a high precision, it's not the good use case for this kind of techniques. And at the end, we have the full homomorphic encryption that works with encrypted data and the multi-party computation that it's good if we have many different players. And of course, all other techniques that are based on hardware security. In my presentation, I will speak about how we can apply different plain text space in the context of the full homomorphic encryption. In the full homomorphic encryption, the circuit operates on encrypted data instead of the plain text, and the person who evaluates the circuit never has any information on the data. As we know, there are many different libraries and techniques in the literature, as the schemes CKKS or BAV or TFICI, but all of them work on different plain text space and good for different application. And in this work, we will show a framework how we can combine the different plain text space using the representation over the torus. And of course, that will give us the possibility to switch between different ciphertext representation. We will start with some definition and just to set our setup. For the integer arithmetic, the homomorphic operation that we need to perform are the additions and the multiplications. Of course, we need to keep the possibility to perform many operations at the cost for just one, or the possibility to do the CMD arithmetic. For that, we see that the three main operations are the addition, the multiplication, and also the permutations between the slots. Usually, the arbitrary precision for the integers, it's not FEG friendly, and it's also not a machine or computer friendly, because we need to work in some space, some finite space, module something, a middle module, to operate exactly as in the C language. For example, we can work with a precision of 32 bits. We should be really careful to avoid the overflow, because if we sum, for example, two numbers of 30 bits, we will completely lose the correctness of the result. In the floating point computation, in some context, as in the physics, we just care about the order of the magnitude. In my example, if we want to know the height of a person, it's enough to know just plus minus 1 centimeter, and it's this result, it will be good enough. And in the case for the radius of the Earth, we can give the result plus minus 10 kilometers. The common part in the both case is that we just need the three most significant decimal digits and not the total result. That means that here our homomorphic operations, it will be not to keep the equality between the addition and the multiplication, but keep the homomorphic properties just on the sum of the most significant bits inside. Of course, here again, we would like to keep the possibility to perform many operations at the cost of one, and the possibility to move between the different slots. And at the end, we have the circuit computation, where our plain text space are the bits, are the Boolean number, 1 and 0, and the basic operations are the XOR and AND. We have three different kinds of interesting circuits. Of course, all circuits that are composed by a Boolean gate, individual Boolean gate, as NAND, AND, XOR, NOT, mute the selector, or also how we can have a possibility to evaluate an arbitrary function or a lookup table. And in my last example, I give also the computation that are based on automata or decision diagrams. I will illustrate in a simple example that in some situation, the construction of the circuit can be really a natural and really the good way to think about the computation. And my example is the comparison circuit. If you want to compare two numbers that are represented by the Boolean representation, now how we can construct a circuit? We will just construct a recursivity about that, starting by the statement that BI, the green part, is greater than the red one, AI. Now my recursivity is just that if the two bits are different, if AI is different from BI, we keep the result from BI. Why? Because if BI is equal to 1, that means that BI, the big one, it's the capital 1, is greater than the AY. That means that statement is true. It's equal to 1 and it keeps the value of BY. And if EI is equal to 1, that means that BI is 0 and the statement is false. And otherwise, we keep the value of the recursivity before. Now, how we can map this statement to a circuit? But it's just a composition between XOR and a selector. The AI different from BI is just a XOR between two values. And the output of my XOR will be my selector. If it's equal to 1, I will take the value of BI. And if it's equal to 0, I take the value of Ri minus 1. Now, just by concatenation of n times this comparator, we have our circuit representation of the comparison. That means that it's really easy to construct an easy example for the comparison between two numbers. Okay. Now, in my second part of the presentation, I will give some definition and I will define the learning with error problem over the torus. And why learning with error? Because, as we know, almost all efficient fully homomorphic encryption scheme today are all based on this problem, or the version of a learning with error. But before, I will just give some notation used in my presentation. The definition of ZnX, RnX, and CnX, that are the ring of polynomials with integer real or complex coefficients modulo Xn plus 1. In my example here, I give the example of the real polynomial. It's just a polynomial with integer coefficients, and at the end we perform the operation modulo xn plus 1. In my case here, n is equal to 2. Of course, we have some good mathematical properties on these structures. The first one is that ZnX, RnX, and CnX with the addition are well defined, and we have the properties of the groups. The multiplication is also well defined. That means that all of them are well defined as rings. We can use the polynomial representation in two different ways to pack the coefficients inside. For example, the first way is the coefficient packing. That means in each position, each coefficient of my polynomial, I will put one plain text, one message. And we have n different slots one for a coefficient. We have also the second way for packing. It's the slot packing where we use the evaluation of the unitary root of x n plus 1, and all my plain text will be the evaluation in one different root. In this case, we have n completely different slots, and of course, here the slots are well defined if you work on the complex. The good news is that there exists a morphism between the two representation, and we can switch between the coefficient and the slot representation just using the van der Mond matrix, and it's efficient and easy way. The slots are well defined. We have exactly n slots if we work on the complex polynomial. Of course, in the case of real polynomials, we have just half of them, because we should complete with the conjugate of the first half to obtain at the end real coefficients. With the integer space, we should be really careful, because we should add some additional constraints to well define the slots. And now, as you said you before, we will try to use the torus representation and put all other plain text representation in the torus one. And first the torus, it's just an real modulo one. And the natural question is why? Why we want to use the torus? Of course, it's not just because we really like to draw the circles. It's some more natural reason is that if we think the human logic, it's for us, it's easier to imagine the integers or the real number. But if we ask the question, the addition and the multiplication, is it a native operation of the computer? And the answer is not, because in the language as C, the representation of the numbers are int 32, int 64, float, double, but it's not a generic representation of the integer or real with an arbitrary precision. Of course, the float and the double are not privacy preserving friendly, because for the definition, and we will see after that, we need to know the exponent. And if we need an information that it's data dependent, it's more complex to use it. And for that, for the representation of the float and the double, we use the fixed point representation. The integers 32 and 64 are native representation of the torus, and with this representation we have some operations as the addition, the external product, the distance and the absolute value that are the native operation, and some of them are completely native for using the assembler. For that, an arithmetic in the machine, in the implementation, to be efficient, we should use this property, we should go to real native operations. Okay, now we say torus, but what are the mathematical properties of the torus? We can represent it with a circle, which the elements are the elements from the circle. We work just the real numbers modulo one. Of course, if we try to define the addition and the multiplication, it's not exactly as before. Here we have that this set is a Z module. That means that the addition, it's well defined with two elements on the torus. The external product with an element from Z, an integer number, and the number from the torus, It's also well defined. But what about the internal product? If you try to multiply two numbers from the torus, for example, 0 and 1/2, is it well defined? No, because 0 is also represented as 1 in my torus. That means that 0 times 1/2 can be equal to 1/2, but also it can be equal to 0 if I take 0 the place of 1. We have two different possibilities. That means that it's not well defined, and my t plus and flap and the times, it's not a ring, but it's just an z module structure. Okay, that it's for the individual elements, but of course we have exactly the same for the polynomial representation. That means the polynomial where each coefficient is an element from the torus. We have the properties, the mathematical properties, that Kx is an Znx module with an external product. Now I will define the learning with error problem based on the torus. That means that my plain text will be an element, some discrete sets from the elements from my circle, from the torus. For example, here we have 1/3 and 2/3. And I will try to encrypt 1/3. The first step is to add a Gaussian noise, a small Gaussian error to my plain text to obtain the phase. Now I will lock this representation just by adding a random mask, a vector from with the torus elements, using also the secret key S from the space 0, 1. Okay, to lock my representation is just I add to my face S times my mask A. And my encryption, my ciphertext, is the mask and the locked representation. To unlock the it or to decrypt it, it's just an subtraction B minus S time A. And depending on the scheme, we will round the face to obtain the nearest plain text in my plain text space. Or also it's possible to keep directly the face as an approximation of my plain text. With this scheme, of course, it's defined in the classical version of the learning with error problem, but it's also well defined using the polynomial representation or the ring version. The good news here is that with the learning with error problem, we already have the property of linear combination homomorphism. That means if we apply any linear combination with public coefficients on my lock representation, at the end I will, after that I unlock it, I will obtain my plain text. Of course, the noise will grow, and we should be careful of the number of the operation in order to keep the decryption correctly. With this representation, the estimation of the noise is easy because it's just the standard deviation of the phase. Okay, we have the possibility to perform any linear combination using the learning with error problem. But now the question is how we can perform the nonlinear functions or products. Of course, we need something additional to give this possibility. And this additional structure is the GSW, or is introduced by Jankri, Shai, and Water. Here I will give just an high-level idea of the principle, but this afternoon in the Ilaria presentation, you will see more details about the this structure. But yeah, the high-level idea here is that we will just encrypt the key. We will have a structure of ring WE encryptions, but not just an encryption of a plain text, but we will introduce the key, the secret inside. This structure will give us the possibility to evaluate again the linear combination, but this time the linear combination with secret coefficients. That means that our coefficients can be an encryption of the TRGSW element with, for example, the key inside. With this structure, now we have an internal product between two elements from TRGSW. But the good news that, the news that we have the external product, it's good, but this one it's not really very efficient. For that, we again use the modular structure as before, with exactly the same structure as the definition of the torus. Here we have the well-defined external product between an element of TRGSW and an element from TRLWE. And this external product is much more efficient than the internal product, because here we work just with a structure matrix and vector and not a multiplications between a big matrix. And another thing that we should also notify, and it's really important, is how the noise growth in this situation, in this external product. And the noise depends just of the norm here of the first, it's a multiplication between the norm of the first element from the TRGSW and the noise of the second one. That means if my encryptions of the TRGSW, if my elements are of a small norm, for example, I take an element from Z, but for example, the binary space 0 and 1, that means that the noise propagation is linear. Okay, now we have a common scheme, a warning with error problem with an addition and an external product, and we will show how we can use this way to encrypt for all different schemes. As we know, we have a different homomorphic encryption scheme as BEV, for example, that it's really good for integer operations, arithmetic, with in a parallel way. We have also a SECKKS that it's a library or a protocol efficient for the approximate number computation. And we have KEEFICHI that it's a good for a single evaluation, for the evaluation of the Boolean circuits or logic for comparison, special computation, and complex circuits. Now, the question is how we can get all benefits without limitation. That means how we can use all schemes together. For example, in the first part of my algorithm, I can use the SECKKS scheme. And in the last one, I can switch to the KEEFICHI for example, final comparison. And here the answer is that we will try to unify all plain text space over the torus. We will put the circuit, the integer, and the fixed point with our KNX representation. Why? Because if we look in all the scheme, the way to encrypt, it's always the same. It's always the warning with error problem, and we always use the same way, the same ciphertext A and B. Okay, starting by the circuits. Our main building block in our TFEG scheme is the selector, is the MUX. What is the MUX? The MUX, as I showed before in my comparison circuit example, is just a selector that, depending of the value of C, we will choose D1, D0 or D1. And the good news here is that this building block, to evaluate it homomorphically, is just a combination between the external product and subtraction and addition. That means that just by evaluating this equation, we can evaluate homomorphically the selector. Now, this selector is used as a building block in almost all our constructions. For example, to evaluate any arbitrary function or to evaluate a lookup table. That means we have an input from the binary space, and the output is an element, it's a vector with elements from the torus. Now, how we can evaluate this lookup table, completely arbitrary lookup table, by using our MUX building block? It's just an evaluation of the tree composed by the MUX. We start by reading the first value, x0, and depending of this value, we will select the good line for one of the output. After that, we will read the second one, and with the selector, we will again select the good subset of the lines. That means for the evaluation of the lookup table, we should evaluate n different, MUX trees. Of course, we have a different optimization, how we can evaluate just one MUX tree at the end of phase using an horizontal or vertical packing. Now, the second construction that is really important for the TFEG is the blind rotate. The blind rotate is the algorithm used for our bootstrapping. What means a blind rotate is an algorithm to just rotate our plain text to another value with an angle that it's a secret value. For example, if you want to evaluate homomorphically the decryption of the LWE, is to compute this value here, the sum of SI times AI, and to turn the around here. For the evaluation of this sum, where S is the secret and of course is encrypted, we should evaluate this circuit where each bit of SI is an encryption of the TLGSW. With the evaluation of this circuit, we can evaluate and compute this value. That means we can decrypt homomorphically, but not just, we can compute any linear combination with a secret coefficients this time. That can be used for the evaluation of any Boolean gate, and the principle is really simple. If you want to evaluate the Boolean circuit, the Boolean gate end, the principle is we just split our circle in two different parts. This one it's correspond to 0 and this one to 1, and I take two representants for 0, one for 0 and one for 1. Now I will perform the classical sum addition between my two elements. That will give me this element this one and this one in function of if I sum 1, 1, 0, 1 and 1, 0 or 0, 0. Now I have these three different points and I will just change the split of the circle, saying that this one will correspond to 0 and this one to 1. And just to change the split, it's evaluated homomorphically with the blind rotate. Okay, we can apply exactly the same for all other binary gates. Now I think we have all principal parts or building blocks for TFHG. And we will go to the second part of the presentation, how we can map the integers with the same structure. But before, I will just introduce some notation or definition. As I said before, it's not possible with the integers to work with an arbitrary precision. And our plain text is a plain text modulo some number p, where p it's not so big, it's not so small, it's a middle or large number. And now we will define the z and x, but this time modulo p is just the ring of polynomials with an integer numbers, where each number is modulo p, and again at the end we perform the modulo xn plus 1. Here, if xn plus 1 has an exactly n roots modulo p, we have the property that z over p zn is isomorphic to znx modulo p. That it's exactly the same analogy as before between between the coefficient and the slot packing. I will show it in my small example here. If I take n equal 2 and p equal 5, now my roots of x 2 plus 1 modulo p are 2 and 3, because 2 to the power 2 square plus 1, it's 0 modulo 5, and 3 square plus 1, it's 10, and again it's 0 modulo 5. Now, with my coefficient representation, if I try to multiply these two polynomials, I will obtain as a result 4 plus 2 times x modulo x square plus 1. Now, if I try to use the isomorphic representation, that means the slot representation, I will just evaluate 1 plus x with the first, with the green root, that will give me 3, and with x equal 3, that will give the value 4. For the second one, we have 3 plus 4 times 2, it's 11. Modulo 5, it's 1, and 3 times 4, 12, plus 3 modulo 5, it's 15 modulo 5, if 0. And now the multiplication, it's just a wise way multiplication, that means 3 times 1, it's 3, 4 times 0 is 0, and my result, my final result, it's 3 and 0, and we can check that that corresponds exactly of the evaluation of this polynomial in the point 2 and 3. Of course, as I said before, to keep the property of the slot representation, we need some additional properties. For example, in the BAV, we should verify some conditions, and the power should be never a power of 2. In the BGV, we can use any value of p, but this time we will work in an additional structure using the extended fields. Now, knowing that we have an isomorphism between Z over PZN and ZNX modulo P, we will use another isomorphism to map our plain text space to the torus. We will use the fact that ZNX modulo P is isomorph of 1 over P ZNX modulo 1. That means we will rescale with the value of P. And now our plain text space is composed by an exact multiples of 1 over P. That means I will discretize completely the torus with the elements that are an exact multiple of 1 over P. Okay, but if now our operations are well defined, for the addition, for the addition on the plain text, of course, yes, the operation of the addition is well defined, module 1. Now for the product, here the product that we will use is the Montgomery one. That means that our product between two plain text will be the product between the plain text times P modulo 1. This product is well defined, but it's well defined if we use an plain text that are an exact multiple of 1 over P. Why? Because if we because we need to lift each time to a real representation, and I will show the problem if the plain text are not an exact multiples. As I said, we need to lift. That means when we will apply the multiplication, we should choose one representant of the value. For example, in my example, I want to multiply 1 over 3 and 2 over 3. I should take one real representant, that means integer plus this number, because we work modulo 1. And if the product is exact, it's not important which representant, which integer I have here, the product will be always the good result. I will always obtain the good multiplication modulo 1. But in the learning with error problem, we work with small noise. We have the phase. We apply the operations directly on the phase. That means that our numbers are not an exact multiples. And in this case, the lift here becomes really important because it depends on the choice of the lift of the representant to keep the correctness of the result. If I take in my in the same example, and I try to apply the product with a small noise and with a small representant. That means for 1 over 3, I will take the representant 5.3333, because 5.3333, it's modulo 1, it's 0.333, and that it's an approximation of 1 over 3. If my representants are small, that means the integer part is small, I will obtain a result that it's close to my final result. But in the case of the big representant, as in this example here, I can completely obtain something not correct and completely false. That means that we need a small representative of the plain text to keep the result correct, and that implies that we should lift the ciphertext to small representative in Rx, where our coefficients are in the interval minus 1/2 and 1/2. Okay. Now we will see how we can apply these two operations, but this time homomorphically. For the addition, it's not special, it's just the addition between the two terms. But now for the multiplication between two numbers, for the internal product between two numbers. What we have an if we try to write the decrypted representation, we have again the Montgomery product. And here, if we try to evaluate this equation, we will obtain a polynomial of S of degree 2. To have a correct ciphertext, we should remove this non-linear part of the secret key. And we have managed this term of S square. We have different possibilities. In the literature, there are many different methods dedicated to relinearization or key switch techniques that allows to realize the product to obtain B minus S time I. But if you look more in detail, the TRGSW provide exactly the multiplication by S. As I said before, with the TRGSW we can evaluate any linear combination with secret coefficients. That means that here we will evaluate this linear combination with the encryption of S using the encryption of TRGSW. That means that we have an exact equivalent or a relation between this internal product P with the expression of our external product. Of course, we should give a meaning of the term A1 times A2 because, as I said before, we cannot multiply two numbers from the torus. But in this case, and we will play with the geometry of the plain text, and here the geometry of the integers are the discrete number 1 over p are represented as a sublattice, and here the ai are the exact multiple of 1 over p, and that means that our product here is well defined. Okay, now in our last family of the plain text space, we have the plain text space of the fixed point representation. There are two different models for the representation of the real number. The first one, as I said before, the one used in C, is the floating point representation. In the floating point representation, we represent a number using the mantissant and the exponent tool. But here the exponent is a data-dependent term. That means it depends of the value of x. And that means that it's not really privacy-preserving friendly. It's not friendly for the AVG, but it's not friendly also for the MPC computation. For that, we will use the fixed point representation. It's exactly the same as the floating point, but this time our exponent two is a public value, and it's fixed. And it's fixed before the computation. Now the exponent is public, is fixed, but we should be really very careful how we will choose it, because if the exponent is too small or too large, we risk the overflow or the underflow problem. As in my example, if I take my exponent too large, 0, I will completely lost the information of the computation. There are also some another trigger part of the fixed point representation. It's, for example, the addition. If I have two numbers represented by the mantissant and the exponent, how we can compute the addition? How we can find the value of the mantis are here using M1, M2, TO1 and TO2 for a given precision arrow. Here, this operation requires a right shift and roundings. That means that it's not more an a linear operation. It's a non-linear operation in this case. Okay, now go back to the homomorphic scheme SECKKS, or this of the scheme that works with fixed point arithmetic. How we can map now the fixed point representation again on our torus. Here we have two different approach, the continuous one and discrete one. And in the continuous approach, we will use a small continuous part of the torus to represent our fixed point number plus the error. That means m times 2 to the tau plus epsilon. But it's important that this time it's just a limit interval. Now to apply the multiplication with this continuous approach, as before, we have the problem of the lift. We should lift x and y to the real representation in the real number, modulo 1. But here we can observe that the lift is just the red function here. It's an aperiodic function, and this periodic function can be approximate with the sinus or any other Fourier series, but of course in just a small interval around the zero. That means that the lift, we can use the sinus to evaluate it. For that we need to take just a small part of the torus. But now the problem is that to evaluate homomorphically the sinus, we can again approximate the sinus by a polynomial, and that means that we need the multiplication. That means to make the multiplication, we need again the multiplication. We have a problem because we cannot directly apply this approach. But the good news with this approach is that we preserve this red interval. That means if we apply many multiplication, we can enough space to continue an illimit number of times. To solve the problem of the product, we used discrete approach here. And in the discrete approach, as before, we will discretize this small interval with an exact multiple of 1 over q. And now we will directly around a and b, that means the plain text mu, on the exact multiple, so multiples of 1 over q. And we will bring us directly in the ring as before, 1 over qzx modulo 1. And we can use again the Montgomery product as before, that it's well defined using the external one. But we have again give a meaning of the term a1 times a2. This time we will use another geometric properties of the plain text space. It will be not the exact multiple as before, but here we will use the geometric properties that our plain text space, it's a small ball and AI are abounded bound values. With this method, now we can evaluate the product. But the problem of this method is that with each operation, this red interval will become more big, large, and we have just a limited number of multiplication, of iteration. for that, the good techniques is to combine the continuous and the discrete approach. Discrete just to evaluate the sinus, and for the real multiplication, we can use the continuous representation. Okay, now to put everything together in the same slide, we can resume that saying that we start with the TRLWE encryption that allows the evaluation of homomorphically of all linear combination with a public coefficient. With the TRGSW, we have the external product and the evaluation of the any linear combination, but this time with a secret coefficient. We have two different possibilities of this secret coefficient. If the secret coefficient is an encryption of 0 or 1, we obtain the operation as the selector, the blind rotate, the bootstrapping of key feature, and all operations as NAND, AND, XOR, and etc. We obtain completely all operations defined in the key feature. If the secret coefficient A is the encryption of the secret key S, we obtain the internal product, and depending on the geometry of the plain text, if we are in the suplatice in this discrete plain text, we obtain the scheme BAV. If we are in the this geometric plain text space, a small ball on the torus, we obtain completely the scheme and all operations of the SECKS, and the possibility to perform all homomorphic operations directly in parallel over the slot and mux, rotate, and etc. That means that we have all operations that I defined in the beginning of my presentation. With this common framework, now we can bridge all different ciphertext space and different schemes and libraries. In my presentation, I explain how we can work with the BAV modulo P, but it's also possible to map the version where we have just one big number and not many slots with small numbers. It's the version of BAV big number, exactly in the same framework. And in the green part, we have all operations and also the bootstrapping of the Heian scheme. Okay, we saw that the torus is something that it's a really generic, can give us the possibility to operate, to make an efficient homomorphic operations with different plain text space that are completely different from the Boolean to the fixed point representation, but exactly the same techniques and exactly the same arithmetics can be used also for the for building an efficient multi-party computation. Here I will just show in one slide some common part, but yes, just to define, but we will have more presentation after that on the multi-party computation. The difference between the FEG and the MPC is that in the MPC case, each data is shared among multiple players, and only by combining of all shares of the players, we can recover the data. And of course, without colluding between the players, so the players cannot get any information on the data. And in our product in Inpher, that we call it XOR engine, and with the torus representation, we call it Manticore. It's a little bit like Chimera, but this time it's another mythic animal. it's multicard. We use the XOR, the torus representation to apply again an efficient fixed point computation with a new lift algorithm, because we have again the same problem as before to lift our numbers in the real representation. But here our lift algorithm is with zero error zero probability of error. That it's not the case really in the algorithm proposed in ABY3. We used also the Fourier evaluation as before, as in the AFIG. But the good news in MPC that for the Fourier evaluation, that we need to evaluate the sinus. We don't need, it's not as in the FHU that for the product we need the Fourier representation, for the evaluation of the Fourier representation we need the product. Here the Fourier representation, the evaluation of the sinus is a native building or native computation on the NPC, and we don't need to go in the discrete representation, we can just use the continuous one. And with these techniques, we can perform a high precision and efficient computation. I just give some benchmark, but the specificity of these benchmarks are that they are not run on arbitrary data or random data, but they are run on the data that are really difficult, that we try to simulate the customer one. That means data that are not feature scaled, that it's completely unbalanced, that there are many singularities inside, because usually the customer data it's not proper, it's not as in the average case, it's really the worst case of all data, of all possible data. And with this kind of data we obtain benchmarks that are really close to the plain text evaluation. That means in plain text here it takes 1 minute 15 seconds, and in our product it takes 1 minute 40 seconds. And of course our objective is to obtain a really high precision, and our precision here it's -7, -8. Of course we are in the honest but curious model, we are not in the malicious model of security. It's my last slides, but yeah, just to give some ideas about all these computations. We saw that we have the arithmetic that are really efficient, but in this computation we have also many parameters that should be pre-computed before. For example, in the fixed point representation we should evaluate or estimate really very well the exponent, the public exponent tau. And it's different for each variable if you want to keep the operations really efficient. That means in this case we need a compiler. We need a compiler for the computation of all these additional values or parameters that are data independent, but they used some information or some orders of the data or of the geometric of the algorithm. And we have a compiler that estimates the good numerical window and the precision of each variable. And this concept is common for the AFIG and for the APC, and can be applied also for all different privacy preserving techniques. And it's all, and thank you very much for the attention.